जॉर्ज चैपमैन, लाइफ एंड वर्क्स, समरी ऑफ द ब्लाइंड बैगर ऑफ अलेक्जेंड्रिया, द ट्रेजेडी ऑफ बसी डी एम्बॉयस, द बैटल ऑफ फ्रॉक्स एंड माइस एंड एंड्रोमेडा लिब्रेटा। हेलो एंड वेलकम टू द डिस्कोर्स। जॉर्ज चैपमैन वॉज बॉर्न इन 1559 एंड ही डाइड इन 1634। ही वॉज अनदर एलिजाबेथन राइटर, पोएट एंड प्ले राइट हु कम्पीटेड विद द जीनियस ऑफ यूनिवर्सिटी विट्स इंक्लूडिंग क्रिस्टोफर मार्लो एंड थॉमस किड and the rising star William Shakespeare during the Elizabethan era, and continued to produce worthy pieces of literature during the Jacobean and Caroline era. He was a proficient poet, prose writer, and dramatist, and he is most remembered for his translations of Homer's Iliad and Odyssey. His translation of Homer contains passages of great power and beauty, and his translation inspired John Keats to compose his sonnets of On First Looking into Chapman's Homer, which was published in 1815. His translation of Homer, titled Crown of All Homer's Work, also influenced T.S. Eliot and Samuel Taylor Coleridge. Chapman published the first book of the Iliad translated in English in 1598, and it was completed in 1611. In 1616, Chapman published the translation of Odyssey. While studying the classical Greek works, he got influenced by the classical philosophies too, and adhered with the ideas of Stoicism, which are often depicted in his works. Stoics believe that virtue is the only good for humans. Other things like wealth, power, physical comfort, etc. are neither good nor bad. Stoics believe that a person must use logic to improve his present while not worrying too much about the future or past. A person should avoid falling into trap of desires for pleasure or fear of pain, but he should keep a good watch on his virtues and adhere to them. Chapman began his career as a philosophical poet and published his first poem, The Shadow of Night, in 1594. In 1595, he published his other philosophical poem, Ovid's Banquet of Sense. Both these poems suggest Stoic principles and stress the benefits of the ordered, virtuous life. In 1596, he wrote a poem praising Sir Walter Raleigh and his exploration of Guiana, which was titled De Guiana Carmen Epicum, or An Epic Poem About Guiana. In this poem too, he stressed the virtuous a warrior hero must possess. George Chapman is also known for finishing the incomplete poem Hero and Leander by Christopher Marlowe, who died before completing it. Chapman was too much involved in the matter of classical Greek literature, and since Marlowe's poem was related to Greek mythology, he got interested and he completed the poem. It was published in 1598. As a poet, Chapman gained such success that many scholars believe that William Shakespeare mentioned him in his sonnet 86 as a rival poet who is attracting the attention of his lover. His most talked about poem is Euthymia Raptus, or The Tears of Peace, which was published in 1609. It was dedicated to Prince Henry, elder son of King James I. In this poem, Homer appears to the poet and introduces him to an allegorical figure, Lady Peace, who complains about the degradation of learning and elevation of power and ambition in the current world. Her complaints or lamentations are her tears. Andromeda Librata. In 1614, Chapman published his poem Andromeda Librata, or The Nuptials of Perseus and Andromeda. He dedicated this poem to the Earl of Somerset and Lady Frances Howard. The poem tells the story of King Cepheus, profoundly disturbed by the monstrous whale sent by Neptune to ruin his kingdom. An oracle suggests to Cepheus that the curse of the whale can be removed only if he shows and sacrifices his daughter Andromeda to the whale. Reluctant, Cepheus considers the situation and decides to chain Andromeda to a rock standing in the sea. Perseus sees Andromeda chained on the rock and falls in love with her. Perseus then finds the way to kill the monstrous whale and saves Andromeda, who is then married to Perseus. This poem became a huge hit because it was dedicated to Somerset and Frances Howard. Frances Howard fought and won a divorce suit against her first husband, Robert Devereux. She proved that she is still a virgin and Robert was impotent. Soon after, Frances Howard married Earl of Somerset. Frances Howard alluded as Andromeda, Robert Devereux as the Rock, and Earl of Somerset as Perseus. Chapman's Batrachia Myomachia, or the Battle of Frogs and Mice. Apart from Homer's Iliad and Odyssey, Chapman also translated Batrachia Myomachia. It is a fabled story of frogs and mice. The story begins as the king of frogs befriends a mouse and asks him to visit his home on the other side of the bank of the river. But the mouse cannot swim, so the king frog suggests he ride on his back as he will take him to the other side of the river and will bring him back. The mouse agrees. In the river, when the king frog takes the mice on his back, they encounter a dangerous snake that can devour both the frog and the mouse. As the king frog gets frightened, he forgets that the mouse cannot swim and dives into the water to escape. While the king frog saves himself from the snake, the mouse drowns in the river. Another mouse was seeing all this happening from the back bank and he informs the whole society of mice. Mice decide that King Frog betrayed their comrade mouse, so he must be punished. They decide to fight against the frogs. The war ensues. God Zeus was observing all these happenings and he suggests all the gods take sides of either the frogs or the mice and take part in the war. Zeus insists that goddess Athena should take the side of mice and help them against the frogs. However, Athena is angry against the mice who harmed her precious dresses, so she refuses to help them. Ultimately, the gods decide not to take part in the war, but to observe what happens. The next day, the war begins and mice clearly overpower the frogs. Zeus gets worried that mice will completely ruin the colony of frogs, and to help them, he sends the army of crabs to help the frogs. The mice are helpless against the armored crabs, and they retreat, and this ends the one-day war between the frogs and the mice. The Blind Beggar of Alexandria. Chapman's comedy, The Blind Beggar of Alexandria, was first performed in 1596. Chapman introduced the Italian tradition of commedia dell'arte in this play, and it was heavily dependent on the comedic effects of disguise. The story is about a poor shepherd, Cleanthes, who is swindler and pretender. He pretends to be a duke to woo Queen Aegil of Alexandria. When it is found that he is not a duke but a pretender, the queen banishes him from her kingdom. Cleanthes goes away only to return to Alexandria as a blind beggar and fortune teller Iris. He also continues to change his disguise to Leon the usurer, madbrain aristocrat Count Hermes, and others to manipulate people and events for his own benefits. He succeeds in seducing Queen Aegil again, and he marries two sisters in different disguises without letting them know that both their husbands are the same man. He then tempts both his wives to commit adultery with his other disguise. He continues to manipulate events in such a manner that leads him to be the king of Egypt, as he marries Queen Aegil, while he abandons his two wives for adultery with two kings who have been captured. Many scholars consider this disguise comedy of Chapman as a parody of Christopher Marlowe's Tamburlaine. In Marlowe's Tamburlaine, a poor shepherd uses his cruelty to win over the world. In Chapman's Blind Beggar, a poor shepherd rises to be the king of Egypt through his disguises and manipulations. The pattern of disguise comedy became popular, and many other writers also used the tradition of disguise comedy. Ben Jonson used it in Every Man in His Humor, Walpone, and The Alchemist. In 1597, Chapman produced An Humorous Day's Mirth. It was the first Elizabethan play based on the concept of humor comedy. Humor comedy suggests that the imbalance of the four humor fluids in a man creates comic characters. We discussed humor comedy while discussing the works of Ben Jonson, whose play Every Man in His Humor is the most successful humor comedy. So, Ben Jonson took inspiration from Chapman from his first two plays, Blind Beggar for Disguise Comedy and Humorous Day's Mirth for Humorous Comedy, for his own play Every Man in His Humor. In 1605, George Chapman collaborated with Ben Jonson and John Marston to produce Eastward Ho, which contained satirical references against the Scottish courtiers of King James I. This play was banned and arrest warrants were issued against all three co-authors. Ben Jonson and George Chapman were jailed while John Marston escaped. Eastward Ho is a city comedy based in London. The main character of Eastward Ho is Touchstone, who is a goldsmith of Cheapside. His two apprentices are Francis Quicksilver and Golding. The tragedy of Bussy D'Amboise. Like other Elizabethan dramatists, Chapman also wrote a few tragedies, and the most talked about tragedies written by George Chapman is the tragedy of Bussy D'Amboise. It was a drama based on the true events and political scenario of France. Bussy D'Amboise was a real French person who was murdered in 1579. Bussy D'Amboise is a poor soldier who is an accomplished swordsman. He begins the play with his soliloquy, in which he reflects on the current corrupt, avaricious and violent society. He says, "Who is not poor is monstrous." What he means is that the society is so corrupt that a gentleman cannot become rich through his abilities and hard work. And if he is rich, it means he sacrificed his innocence and became corrupt, monstrous. Soon it is revealed that Bussy himself is a hypocrite, as he collects £1,000 to offer as a bribe to enter the service of Monsieur, younger brother of King Henry III. Monsieur wants to collect a group of henchmen to fulfill his political ambitions. While Bussy D'Amboise gets an entry in service of Monsieur, he is not a follower by nature. He is argumentative and independent, and hence cannot be just a political tool to fulfill the ambitions of politicians. Yet he proves to be weak against women as he gets involved in an illicit affair with Tamara, wife of an influential politician, Count Mountsari. Count Mountsari gets some inkling about the affair and he tortures his wife to force her to confess about the illicit relationship with Bussy. She confesses and she is forced to write a letter in her own blood to Bussy, inviting him for a romantic meet. Tamara's chaplain, a friar, who used to pass her messages to Bussy D'Amboise, passes away. He dies in shock as he sees Tamara facing all the tortures. Count Mountsari then disguises himself as a chaplain and goes to Bussy to deliver the letter to him. Tamara's chaplain's ghost appears and meets Bussy, informing him about the tortures she went through. He also informs him about the impending danger as Mountsari seeks revenge against Bussy for corrupting his wife. However, Bussy fails to react in time and Mountsari reaches his home to trap him with the letter. In the end, Bussy D'Amboise is gunned down in the ensuing battle. In 1613, George Chapman produced a sequel to this play, which was titled The Revenge of Bussy D'Amboise. In this play, Clermont D'Amboise takes revenge for the murder of his brother and succeeds in engaging Mountsari in a duel to face him and kills him. Bussy D'Amboise is a character with some high moral values who battles with his own lower tendencies and succumbs to them. John Dryden criticized Chapman's style of writing in Tragedy of Bussy D'Amboise as dwarfish thought dressed up in gigantic words. His other tragedy was The Tragedy and Conspiracy of Charles, Duke of Biron, which was again based on true events involving a French soldier, Charles de Gontaut, who was executed for treason in 1602. Chapman wrote a classical tragedy, Caesar and Pompey, in 1612, which was based on Plutarch's Parallel Lives translation and talks about the relationship between Caesar and Pompey and the pupil-master relationship between Pompey and Cato the Younger, who was the teacher of Pompey. Chapman had a good relationship with Inigo Jones, to whom he dedicated his part of the poem Hero and Leander. He collaborated with Inigo Jones to produce a mask titled The Memorable Mask of the Middle Temple and Lincoln's Inn. Inigo Jones designed the costume and set for this mask while Chapman wrote it. It was performed as a festivity to celebrate Princess Elizabeth's nuptials. Princess Elizabeth was the daughter of King James I and she was married to Frederick V in 1613. So this is all about George Chapman. We have discussed all his major works. We will continue to discuss the literature of the Jacobean and Caroline era. Stay connected with the discourse. Thanks and regards.